The following content is provided under a Creative Commons license. Your support will help MIT OpenCourseWare continue to offer high-quality educational resources for free. To make a donation or view additional materials from hundreds of MIT courses, visit MIT OpenCourseWare at ocw.mit.edu.
There are a lot of ideas in Chapter 4. About a quarter of them are rewritten from the Society of Mind. And it isn't till the next chapter that, right in the middle of the book, that I try to describe the mind as made of a big stack of six different layers of, I guess the introduction mentioned that, but six different layers of structures, each of which reacts to what's happening in the layer below it. And that's something we sometimes call Model 6 for no particular reason. And so in the sort of at this section in the in Chapter 4, it talks about the idea that in the early days of psychology, well, around 1900, there were some very simple theories based on various experiments with rats and other, shouldn't call them simple mammals. If you think about it, the small mammals like rats and mice, what did it do? In the very, when I say early days of psychology, that's a strange thing to say, because if you read Aristotle's book on rhetoric, which is a fairly big one, it's full of ideas about how the mind works, and then then I don't know very much in between, but if you go to the era of English philosophers like Hume and so forth, then you see theories. Well, Hume is kind of strange theories about the associations of ideas and so forth. And at the beginning of the 19th century, we find people like Watson and Pavlov who invent a very simple form of rule-based system that Pavlov called conditioned reflexes. And in these descriptions of psychology, this was later elaborated by B.F. Skinner, who was a very famous psychologist of the 1930s through 70s. And I made friends with him when I was an undergraduate at Harvard and played around with, I was good at electronics, so I helped with the instrumentation. What Pavlov and those people did at the beginning of the 19th century was do systematic experiments on animals, and the standard theory became what is now called reinforcement theory. You put the animal in a situation, for example, in Skinner, what Skinner did was make the study of animal behavior sort of scientific in the sense that he restricted all sorts of variables. What Pavlov did is he would show something to a dog, maybe a piece of meat, play a certain sound, and if the dog did something like sit, then Pavlov would reward it with something that acts as a reward for the animal. So that's called a conditioned reflex. You have a certain stimulus, the animal could do a variety of things, and you pick a particular one, and you reward the animal if it does that particular one. And then after a couple of hundred trials, the dog will do exactly what you have been rewarding it for very reliably. Then if you provide the stimulus again, and the animal sits, or whatever you want it to do, if you Well, the stimulus could be just sit. If you say sit, the dog will do something or other, or whatever it does, you can regard it as its response. And if it's the response you like, you reward it. After it's very well trained to do that, what happens if you say sit and it doesn't sit? I'm sorry, if it sits and you don't reward it, well, then it'll look puzzled. And if you do that a few times, then you'll find that when you say sit, it doesn't promptly sit. And in fact, if you've rewarded it 1,000 times, and then you give this command maybe 20 times in a row and don't reward it, then the 21st time it probably won't sit. It's as though it erased the rule. What Skinner discovered made a revolution in animal training. I imagine a lot of animal trainers knew this, but they didn't publish in journals. Skinner discovered that if you reward the animal every time, then it gets trained to produce this stimulus response event very reliably. And if you stop rewarding it, then it rather quickly stops responding in the way you've trained it. And you might say it's forgotten. However, Skinner discovered that if you start to train it again, it will very quickly learn. Maybe it will start reliably responding in just 20 trials instead of the maybe couple of hundred or whatever it took the first time. But Skinner discovered another thing that hadn't been observed by animal behaviorists. What happens if you tell the dog to sit, and it does, and you reward it only, say, one out of every five times? Then it'll take a little longer to train, but not much. And then if you start saying sit and don't reward it, it might continue to obey the command reliably for a couple of hundred times. In other words, intermittent, unreliable reinforcement. And Skinner would have a random interval. If you, in fact, rewarded it every five times, some dogs would actually wait for you to order it five times before it sits. But if you did it randomly so that it couldn't predict when the next reward was, then it sometimes took as many as 50 or 100 times as long to make that response disappear. Anyway, that's something that isn't really often described in the older textbooks on conditioned reflexes because it hadn't been known. When you extinguish a response in an animal that's been constantly trained, it hasn't really forgotten it. It's somehow suppressing it. And that was one of the reasons that I began to think about critics and about censors, that a memory isn't erased by non-use, but it may actually get suppressed if it turns out that that response doesn't lead to success for a while. So in other words, the animal will persist much longer if it was randomly rewarded. And again, when you start rewarding it more often, it will almost instantly jump back to the previous level of responding reliably. So that suggests that you're not changing. Now, you could look at conditioned reflexes as what AI researchers call rule-based systems, namely, you can think of the poor animal as just a catalog of two-part rules. If this happens, do that. If this happens, do that. And around 1980, one of the reasons why artificial intelligence stopped making progress is that before 1980, lots of us worked on getting computers to solve really hard problems, like problems in calculus or finding new ways to make them better at playing games. I mean, people still worked on making them play games better, but as I think I said the other day, when Deep Blue won the world championship, it didn't have a significantly larger collection of strategic ideas or knowledge about chess than Greenblatt's program in 1970, which was the first chess program that would reliably beat not beginner chess players. Couldn't beat master chess players, but at an amateur tournament, it turned over, won a few games. So there was this idea of a rule-based system that became very popular around 1980, mainly from a PhD thesis by Ed Feigenbaum, who I think was a graduate student at Stanford at that time. And it became very popular to say, could we make systems that are just based on rules without any internal models or complicated reflective searches or whatever in the 1980s, and progress on finding good heuristics for improving search processes and so forth sort of disappeared. I just mention all that because you see lots of commercial applications of artificial intelligence systems, but you don't see ones that do dramatically interesting kinds of reasoning or problem solving very much after that. So this idea of a rule-based system, a collection of if-then rules, became popular. And what I'm suggesting in this early part of the chapter is that if you're looking at something like human thinking, there aren't just rules about how to react to an external situation, but there might be a second level of the brain, which is regarding the Pavlovian, the rule-based system, as its world. And the second layer of the brain might be learning some ways to manipulate what happens in the first world, in the sensory motor part of the system. Why is this important? Because if you go back and look at Pavlov and even Skinner, they kept improving their ideas of under what conditions a rule gets reinforced. But when you present the dog or the rat with a stimulus, how does it decide what response to try? And you don't see any discussion of that. Skinner made a name for that. That's called operant conditioning. Namely, you put the animal in a situation, and somehow the animal makes a response. And then the reinforcement may sort of suppress or increase the probability or whatever, however you want to describe it, of that response. But there isn't much talk about how it decides how to respond. Does the dog just look up in a table what to do when it hears the phonemes in the word sit? Well, that's what the rule-based system would require, that there's some sort of table which says for each input condition, what should you do? But does the dog say, well, I could do a lot of things. The last few times that I sat, I got a reward. And when I didn't sit, I didn't get a reward. You don't see that kind of thinking in the so-called behaviorist tradition that I've been describing, where you just make a catalog of what are the behaviors of the animal, and then try to make a set of rules that explains the behaviors that you've observed. Where are the rules that say which behaviors to not produce? And in an ironical way, Professor Noam Chomsky, who's very well known for having sort of won a big public argument with Skinner, has been described as the person who conquered the behaviorists. But Chomsky himself is very much like Skinner in the sense that he's taking all the sentences people, you say a lot of sentences to people, or a lot of strings of words, and the person has two responses. That's a sentence, that's not a sentence. Then Chomsky asks, what kind of machinery could produce this particular kind of behavior? Not the behavior of saying sentences, exactly, but the behavior of which speech actions are called sentences. And then he explains that by a collection of rules, which aren't a table because they're more sophisticated and nested, which describe the set of all possible sentences. But at least in the older, I don't know what Chomsky has written in the last decade or so because I gave up, and I may have missed some great new ideas. But generally, his descriptions are ways to describe the set of acceptable responses, or the set of expressions that are regarded as sentences, without a theory of what produces them. So the grammar rules are sort of like a rule-based system, which when applied to an utterance will either accept or, if you can find a set of grammar rules which produces that utterance, then it's a sentence, and if you can't, then it's not. So in some sense, he's as much of a behaviorist as Skinner was, because neither of them ask, under what conditions will you produce a particular sentence? Or even more important, perhaps, because a lot of what people say aren't sentences, like the one I'm just finishing now. That wasn't a sentence, and you know exactly what it meant. So it doesn't explain very much of human verbal behavior. It does explain, in many cases, which utterances, after careful analysis, you will decide is a sentence, and that's a sort of behavioristic criterion, not a cognitive one. Well, enough denouncing Chomsky. It's one of my hobbies, so. But it's interesting that neither Pavlov or Skinner discuss very much how does the animal decide what to try? And obviously, when you think about that for about 10 seconds, you say, well, that's much more important than making a description from the outside of just which responses come how often to which stimuli. Where did the responses themselves come from? So then the next theory is, well, why have two levels? Why not have another level? And the main model of the book, I shouldn't say the main one, because really the strategy in the emotion machine project, or the whole idea, is that we don't want to be like physicists and say, here are the laws of thought. The reason for that is that what a physicist does is to look for a very small number of rules. In the case of the human brain, you know that there are 400 different pieces of machinery, and the behavior of all the different mammals are quite different in some respects. They're all similar in others. And so no very simple theory could explain it. The biggest part of the evidence from neurology is that there are lots of different parts of the brain, and if you injure one, then the animal's behavior changes in various ways. It's usually can still solve lots of problems in some realms, but not in others. So it wouldn't be a matter of a small number of basic principles. Then the rest of the book jumps into this idea of asking, I didn't realize I had that in that chapter. I talked a lot about the duplication and diversity there. But the chapter is called Consciousness, and anybody want to describe what they, how would you describe or explain when a human action is conscious or not? Anybody want to try a description? When would you say you made a conscious decision?
You predicted realize that all those things matched the punches that you did?
When you had a description of what you were going to do already.
Right.
But it needs a little more than that. You have to know that you had the description. What if the description were in this part of your brain, and the part that's, actually the part of your brain that's talking is in most people on the left side. So what if the description were over here, and you weren't able to say that you had one? But what if the description were actually there in some other part of the brain? Would that be conscious, or would it just be a matter of your being able to describe it with your verbal output? In other words, how do you know what you're conscious of? Is it just only verbal? Well, of course, it's not verbal. For example, if I'm thinking about picking up this Coke bottle, I'm aware of, what would you call it, I have a little virtual world, and I can feel my arm going out, and I can feel that when it gets about here and touches it, I'll get a sensation of cold and so forth. And I presumably could do that without having had any verbal conception, or of course I can't be sure that. Maybe there's a second language area that deals with semantics, with semantic symbols that aren't words. And before you speak, that other thing is operating. And if you don't happen to feel like talking, you might never realize that you had something just below the surface of a verbal expression.
For instance, I was looking at Japanese characters, and they feel completely different from English characters, because the words go straight up.
In columns? Do you mean? Or
straight up in terms of, you know, the features of the letters, the ink. I'm not conscious of all that. I'm not conscious of the lines that are very particular in Japanese characters.
Uh-huh.
But when I look at English words, I'm instantly aware of the meaning of it instead of looking at the low-level descriptions that are being built up.
I think sometimes you can have two Japanese characters that have the same pronunciation, can't you?
Yeah.
Because I was once watching two people talk and in Japan, and the first one said something the other said, didn't understand. The first one said, well, I mean this. And he made a few brush strokes because there wasn't any. Pronouncing it more clearly wouldn't help.
Symbols, then we might be conscious of the processes that, you know, we are trying to learn from.
Yes.
Or the representation that we're building. But once we've done that, then maybe we have lost the intermediate description that we build things upon.
Exactly. It's like the difference between a high-level program and a compiled one. Presumably, when you're an expert, when you're a beginner, this teacher tells you all these rules, or you learn them somehow, or look them up. I actually remember when my father explained how chess worked, and I couldn't believe anybody could do that in real time, because he would explain that, well, the knight can move two forward and one this way, or two this way, or one this way, and there are eight different ways. And after a few games, those rules have disappeared, and you've compiled it. Each person must have a different new compiled representation, but mine is that the knight has this jaggedy circle around it, and it's perfectly obvious if the knight is on this black square, then these eight white squares just turn pink or something. You can think of it as colors or something, but they just jump out. And wherever the knight is, it has this aura around it. And that happens without thinking. If you had to think, you would never have time to make your next move. Well, as the chapter says at the beginning, there's a lot of great many very smart people feel that there's a big mystery about consciousness. Could you have a zombie machine, as it's been called, which does exactly, could you have a brain which is just like your brain and it does everything you do, it's absolutely identical to you, except that it does, it's not conscious of what it's doing. And people like David Chalmers, who's a well-known philosopher of consciousness, says, well, it's logically perfectly possible that there could be another person just like you, with a brain just like yours, except that it doesn't have any conscious experience. And I think I might have mentioned that somewhere in this book. When he says logically possible, I think he's confused. What do you mean logic? To say that something follows logically from another thing, one statement follows logically from another statement, doesn't mean anything by itself, because the word logic refers generally to a set of axioms, a set of assumptions, of which the average person probably has 60 million or something like that. That's my one of the estimates I like, that a person knows the order of 50 or 100 million fragments of information. So when you say something is logically possible, it means that given these 100 million axioms and given the rules by which you can derive a new sentence from one or two or more already established axioms or already established conclusions, that's what logically possible means. And Chalmers is saying it's logically possible in the sense that he thinks he can imagine these two machines, one of which is conscious and one isn't, but they're otherwise the same. There's nothing logical about it. I don't believe he can imagine either of those machines. He can only make sentences about them and publish them and convince other people that they make sense. How do you imagine a machine that's the same as you, but it's not conscious? All you can do is imagine that somebody would understand that sentence in some way. Yeah?
Could we build like a very simple Bloch's world with a character there doing something that people would agree that it's conscious of itself?
Well, they'd have to define conscious.
Well, I mean that if you agree that, you know, if I think that this guy is conscious, then that guy is conscious.
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure what you say. You're saying, well, let's assume that he's conscious and he is,
and
they behave the same.
They behave the same, they speak the same language.
All right, but what is it you're imagining?
I'm imagining a Bloch's world system,
yeah,
which has a few guys in it who are building something or doing something.
Mm-hmm.
And it has a lot of processes that, let's say, that people are talking about. And would people agree that those characters are conscious? What's the test? Like, what's the...
How would they... What would it mean to... What matter would it be if they agreed? What would they mean? If the machines are the same, and you're saying, well, I can imagine that this machine isn't conscious and this one is, I don't see what you're imagining.
Well, I'm not trying to define the word consciousness, but
well,
I don't even know what it means.
Mm-hmm. Then how can you imagine what it would be for this one not to be conscious,
well,
if you have no idea what it means? Well, I'm just saying, in my opinion, Chalmers doesn't have any idea of what that would mean. And so he says it's logically possible, meaning I can't imagine anyone objecting to this, or something like that. He's not making a statement about consciousness, because he's saying, that's a mystery. I don't know what it is. I don't think it's describable in physical terms. He has all these negative things. He says, this is a very hard problem, which probably no one will ever solve. But I don't think, when he says it's logically possible that there's this difference, as Penn Jillette would say, I think that's just word salad. You look at that and say, well, Chalmers is saying that he sees some meaning in this assertion, but I don't see any reason to believe him. Maybe because I don't see him as ever having any other good ideas about psychology. Well, that's mean. Maybe he has had. Oh, but in fact, the trick in this chapter, I think this is sort of original. Maybe you've seen something like it. But what I try to do is be a little more behavioristic and say, what's going on when a person says, I consciously decided to pick up that bottle of Coke, something like that. What do you think is happening in a person's mind when they use the word conscious? And the first part of the chapter, you remember about Joan crossing the street, describes about 20 or 30 different kinds of things that must have been going on in her mind when she was making that decision. And I left it to the reader to say, well, I think this one, where she's thinking about her recent thoughts, is conscious or not, and so forth. So I didn't say, when I listed those 30 things, mental activities that she was in, I didn't, actually in the first draft, I tried to make a judgment about which ones the average person would call conscious, and then I gave up. But then I thought about it a lot more, and so in this section, I was saying, well, when somebody says that they did something consciously, what could they be saying? And after a while, I decided that it very likely uses these four properties, which are sort of computational ones. So one thing is, when you talk about conscious, one feature is that you're talking about yourself, probably explicitly. You don't say, a conscious decision was made. You say, I made this decision consciously. What do you mean by I? And I doesn't mean you. I means, or me. I means the current process is using a model of myself. I'm a big machine. Somewhere in this machine is something that it often uses to make predictions of what the body of this machine will do, or what the mouth of this machine will speak, or something. And so the word I means that you're thinking about some representation or theory about what's inside your head, assuming that, like most Westerners, you think your mind is in your head. I've been told that in some other cultures, people think the mind is in your chest or your belly, but I don't believe them.
Excuse me?
Yeah. Among your descriptions of self are some simplistic ones. Is that what you're saying?
I'm saying most people have simple descriptions of self. Otherwise, they would find it very hard to say something like, I did it.
Well, no. When they say I, they're using...
If you understood your complex, then you would be like, oh, it doesn't mean anything. This part of my brain said this, and this part of my brain said this.
Yeah, but the talking part of your brain is using this word I, and like any...
It's just a matter of training. I mean, you could train yourself to completely make the word I not mean anything.
Well, Freud says my superego does this, and my id does this, and my ego does this. So yes, you can train yourself to regard yourself as made of three parts, and most people don't. But even if you don't, you still may have 16 models, and just like the word chair, you use it as though it were, you don't disambiguate it, because A, at the moment you're not, you don't have a representation of yourself as a lot of subselves, or as a chair. You might have a representation as something that you could sit on, and you don't say it's a chair like this, or it's a bamboo chair, or a five-legged office chair, and so forth, even though every one of you probably has 50 or 60 rather different objects that you'd recognize as a chair. That doesn't bother you when you say, I'm looking for something, a chair to sit on.
Sit on, but it's still a chair.
Right. I think in the society of mine, I don't know if I had it in this book, there's a picture of a broken chair, which if you sat on, you would break your hip or something. So when you use conscious, I think one thing that you do is you're using some representation of yourself, or maybe several. Another thing, I think, although this is, that doesn't seem quite, in fact, the next two aren't quite so necessary. I think when people talk about being conscious of something, they usually mean that they're aware of some kind of serial sequential process. They can say, I thought this first and that first and so forth. Not too insistent on that. I'm pretty sure that it means that, of course, parts of their brain are reacting in using a statistical Bayes net or something. And one of the features of a statistical Bayes net is inputs come in and outputs go out. And if you stuck some probes in the middle, you wouldn't get any information about how it produced that output, because there's a great book that came out in the early 1980s called Parallel Distributed Processing, which was sort of a, who's it by? I might remember in a minute. The trouble is I thought Hinton, and my theory of name recognition is, what?
McClellan? Is it by McClellan?
McClellan, Rummel, Hart, and one more. Who's the neuro one out in West Coast? Three guys. Yes, it's McClellan, Rummel, Hart, and
Hinton.
I don't think Hinton was an author of that book.
Yeah.
Is he really?
Yeah, I think so.
Maybe. Well.
Oh, it says Rummel, Hart, McClellan, and the PDP Research Group.
Ooh. That's pretty good. Did you look that up on the web? And you're using symbolic descriptions. I think that's fairly necessary. You can say, I was conscious of a feeling in the pit of my stomach. But I still claim you're using a symbolic description of that, or you couldn't say it. And maybe most important, you couldn't say anything about how you made the decision unless you the process that's making that statement and finding the words and assembling that utterance had access to some record of what your mind was doing recently. Namely, it was trying to solve this problem and it had two alternatives, and it, after a long time, it chose this one rather than that one, which means that it had to have a sort of symbolic representation. It couldn't have been just a big neural net that had these waves of activity, and then A appeared at the output instead of B, because you wouldn't say I was deciding, or you might say something was going on and suddenly I found myself forced to do this or that, which wouldn't fit the idea of a conscious. And then the chapter has a long discussion of those four ideas. And I'm really not particularly happy with that particular description, except that it leads to this diagram, which this is a diagram which you could use to say when a person is likely. Oops, this is the wrong diagram. Imagine all the arrows going the other way. Then this is what I keep pointing to that instead of that, and I didn't bring the light pen. But if you think of that model of that diagram backwards, you could say here's a piece of machinery that would account in many cases for when a person is likely to use the word conscious. And you don't see anything like that in the Journal of Consciousness Studies, because they think consciousness is a mysterious single thing. And this is saying there isn't any such thing as consciousness, but there are a lot of mental activities which any combination of which might lead a person to use the word conscious. And how can you help from pointing to that? And when that trouble detector notices that all four of those kinds of processes are operating, perhaps in the frontal lobe of your brain. I don't know if people who have lost their frontal lobe claim to be conscious or not. So there's a theory of when a person might say conscious, and I think it fits a lot of the descriptions of the conditions under which people say they're conscious. And that's the kind of theory I like to see. It still doesn't say what's, maybe those are the four wrong parameters, and I'd love somebody to suggest that one that I've obviously left out and shouldn't have, or that you don't need. Maybe there's no reason to think that you need serial processes for this to happen or whatever. I don't know. So then there are four long sections about.
Actually, yeah. Think about it. You probably have serial processing going on for language processing.
Yes.
But if you are painting a picture on a canvas, mm-hmm. Might you not use some kind of parallel processing to imagine the different elements in that picture, or when composing a piece of music or something for harmony?
Well, certainly there's so much data in a two-dimensional thing that if you had to look at each point separately, you would lose track and you'd have to keep starting over. So, but I think what an artist would say, you ask the artist, why did you put that figure of a person not in the center but a little over to the right? And if he were a traditional artist, he might say, well, everyone knows that if you put something right in the center, then the reader, the viewer, doesn't know whether to look left or right after they've seen the figure. People have little amateur psychological theories of why you shouldn't put. In fact, if you look at a book on drawing, you'll find statements like, it's best to put the center figure 30% from one side or the other, not 50%. And you certainly don't want to put it right in the middle. How many of you have tried to learn to draw from a drawing book? They have a lot of principles, and they're not all compatible.
Oh, yes.
But my theory of that art is the same as engineering. There's just one big difference. In engineering, you normally have a lot of specification. You have a lot of goals you have to achieve. If you're making a DVD player, there are a lot of constraints, like the power button ought to be at the left, only it isn't always there. But since it's on the left in 90% of devices, why is that right? Raise your hand if you have a DVD player with the button on the right side. What?
Mine's on the left.
Most of them are on the left. I have this Motorola phone, which has the wrong. I think if you press this, it goes off, the left side.
This one is on the right.
Is it a Motorola? Isn't everyone else's on the left? Yes, mine's on the right. But I used to use some other brand, so when the phone rings, I press the one on the left, and it shuts off the call. How many of you have phones with the talk button on the left? How many of those are Motorola's? I talked to some executive, and he said, yes, this was a big mistake, but we're afraid to change it. So what I described the last few minutes was the consciousness recognizer.
You were talking about how art is like engineering.
Thank you. Yes. And so in engineering, you have a bunch of goals you want to achieve. And in fact, there's a sublist which you absolutely have to achieve or the product won't work and so forth. And so you focus on those, and if you can make it have a few other virtues, that's fine. So there's a lot of problem solving, and how do you make a thing that achieves these 12 goals? In art, I think it's the process is the same, except an artist always has more goals than you can achieve. I mean, he wants this painting to do everything. And I know a lot of artists, and my impression is they spend a lot of time deciding which goals to scrap for this particular work. Like, if they're going to make a bronze statue, they'd like it to be 8 feet tall, but that would cost $60,000, so they'll make it this tall. And so they give up the goal of being 8 feet tall because they want it to be made of bronze and so forth. So my this is a parody. My parody of an artist is an artist is just like an engineer, only the main problem is that the artist has a wider range of possible goals. He wants to make a lot of people feel happy, or he wants to make all the people in the world feel terrible, and but he can't achieve that, so he has to make some kind of compromise. So a lot of the artist's work goes into deciding what set of goals should I achieve in my next painting, or composition, or sculpture, or whatever. And once those settle down, then there's no difference between the artist and the engineer, and he has to get this thing enough off-center, but not too much. And if he can't get it there, well, maybe he can make a little more crowded stuff over here to make it look like it's further. You know, all those little interactions that every artist that many artists exploit. So there's not very much difference as far as I can see. They're both doing heuristic searches. They have slightly different heuristics. But the artist is more ambitious in a sense. The artist wants to make everybody, I don't know what the artist wants, but you get the idea.
Pretty ambitious too.
Yeah. Steve Jobs wants everybody to not use anything except a Mac ever again, and he does all sorts of things to make this happen, and they don't, but he's as much of an artist as any artist I know. And then the other half of the theory is exactly the opposite, namely, why are people conscious? And the answer is when you're stuck. You've been working on this problem, puttering around, and nothing's happening. And you say to yourself, well, this is terrible. I must focus on this. I have to concentrate. I ought to crystallize what I'm doing. I've got to evaluate the procedures I'm using and blah, blah, blah. And so I summarized this by saying that consciousness is a great thing because when you're in trouble and you're not solving a problem, I mean, you can solve a lot of problems by Zen Buddhism, where you just don't do anything and you don't think about the target and you pull this thing back and the arrow flies right into the bullseye. I don't care what the Zen people say. The idea is if you have pretty good compiled code, then thinking about it will mess it up. And the idea that you should not think about keeping your gun steady. I have a great example. I once went to the Rockefeller Institute with Seymour Papert to talk to some guy about something. But instead of discussing that, he said, well, let's play pool. They had a pool table in the recreation room. And I'd never played pool, so I went like that, and the ball went the wrong way, and nothing worked. And he said, I know what's wrong. I said, what's wrong? And he said, you're trying to hit the ball with the end of the cue stick. And I said, so? And he said, it's a very bad strategy. What you must do is, here's the ball. Don't try to hit the ball with the end of your cue stick. Imagine another ball 4 inches away, past it, and try to hit that ball with the end of your cue stick. So I tried that, and the thing went right in the pocket, and I got 8 in a row without any practice. So he said, well, do you know why that works? I said, well, no. And he said, whenever you make a motion like that, bring your hand as close to the nose as fast as possible. Well, what you don't do is contract your back biceps with maximum force, because then you'll smash your nose. What you do is you make this plan, although you don't know you've made this plan, and the plan says, I'm going to contract my biceps until about gets about here, and then I'm going to contract my triceps so that it stops. Because you see, if you don't have another muscle in the opposite direction, then if you stop here, it'll just coast, and you'll still get a bloody nose.
So you're trying to stop it at the ball.
If you try to stop at the ball, then your antagonist muscle will engage 4 inches before you hit the ball and spoil your aim, because this muscle pulls your arm here. But this muscle is not exactly at the opposite part, but it's about 10 degrees off. So you see, as soon as that one goes, it's very cute. So this way you fool your cerebellum and spinal cord from turning on. It's called the decelerator muscle. For almost every action, there's an accelerating part and a decelerating part. And as far as I can see, most of what people have told me about Zen Buddhism has nothing to do with the simultaneous consciousness of everything in the universe or stuff like that. Almost all of it is explained by this is a really stupid trick for fooling your decelerator muscle not to spoil your aim. And I'm very mistrustful of ancient wisdom just because if it hasn't changed for 1,000 years, then there must be something in the executive bureaucracy that's keeping science out. What was true in 1700 was that there was this great caloric theory of heat, that heat was a fluid and it flowed from the hot places to the cold places because there's more of it and if there was room to go somewhere else. And it explained a lot of Heider's of thermodynamics, but not enough. And the caloric theory was the best theory there had been for a couple of thousand years, and it took about 100 years to go away as the kinetic theory of heat appeared. However, the Zen Buddhist theory of archery doesn't go away now that we know about physiology because of you know what. because there are a lot of very wise people who make their living from it. So anyway, you see, once you've got that theory of how you know when you're being conscious, you see that it's not a complete bullshit theory, because having the concept is great. Because then if you're stuck and you're not doing very well, you say, well, I must be more deliberate or conscious or any more synonyms for that? Reflective. What?
Aware.
Yeah, I should be more aware of what I'm doing. And so as soon as you say that, your compiler has compiled that into, oh, turn on more self-models, turn on more reflective processes, get yourself working serially so that if something goes wrong with the process, you'll detect it right away instead of it being buried in noise, and start sorting through your recent memories to see where you might have made your mistake and so forth. So consciousness is a great idea, provided you don't believe it's a mysterious thing, but say, I'm saying it's these four things. I'm really hoping somebody will find five others that are pretty different that, yeah.
It seems like the trouble detector is kind of the hard part, right? Like, so what?
Which?
The trouble detector is kind of, so I mean, if I'm doing a task and my brain is sort of involved in something, it's sort of like, when do you know that, you know, enough, now is the time to, you know, bring it up a level.
The rest of the book is about these things called critics, and maybe this trouble detector is one of the first examples. And then I generalize it and say all thinking involves doing stuff you know how to do, but having other things recognizing not that you're in trouble, but what kind of trouble you're in. And this consciousness detector is maybe what you do when everything else has failed at lower levels and you're still screwing up, and it says, well, screw those lower levels. Let's get some reflective, symbolic, analytical, serial, logical processes going and see if we can take this thing apart and find, in other words, instead of I'm made of bad protoplasm, I can't aim, you're saying, well, is there some other way I can fool my whatever I'm doing? For example, if you've ever shot a gun, which I was once in the Navy and we got some training, and one of the things is that if you're firing a 30-30 rifle, it's a big bang and it really hurts and so forth, so just as about to pull the trigger, you wince because you're expecting this terrible noise, and so you have to turn off. You have to figure out some way to, and what some people say is, you should squeeze the trigger so slowly that you don't know when it's going to go off, and that way you won't wince just as it happens, because it takes 100 milliseconds to react to something. By that time, the bullet is on its way. You know, human reaction time is between 100 and 200, 1 2/10 of a second. So my colleague Seymour Papert did a lot of research on juggling, and in fact we hired professional jugglers to tell us how they did it, and the most important piece of advice is don't keep your eye on the ball, because if you juggle one ball and you track it, there's no problem. If there are two, in the first place you can't keep your eye on the ball, and the second place, if the ball is over here and your hand is here, it's too late. So in fact, what a good juggler does is you only look up here and you look for the top of the parabola, which is a great time because the ball's going really slowly and you've got plenty of time. And then some part of your brain extrapolates that and gets your hand ready to go there. Of course, in the meantime, there's another ball that's already gone by and your hand was here to receive it. But after about 40 minutes, the average person is able to get two of these going, and less than 2 hours, if you really focus, you can start doing three-ball juggling. We actually had a PhD thesis on this by a clever guy named Howard Austin, and Austin took all these notes that we had made from the professional jugglers and set up a course. And the course was how to juggle, and it had three basic principles. The most important principle was that one mistake you're liable to make is that the ball goes forward, so you step forward to get it. Well, then you're doomed, because the next ball is going to go further and you crash into the wall. And the way the pros deal with beginners is that you juggle right next to the wall, so you can't walk forward, and that cures that. And then there's the looking up here with what's going on, and because if you look here, it's too late. You can't react and you can't learn much. And I forget the third rule. But the joke was that it took the untrained people about 40 minutes to reach a certain skill level. And with Howard's 20-minute course, then it took them only 20 more minutes to reach that skill level. And he came out with this wonderful collection of data which says it takes 40 minutes to learn to juggle this well, whether you teach your, whether you're trained or not. Which we regarded as a great positive result, but other people said, what's the use then if it doesn't? But the conjecture is maybe for five ball juggling, something like that would help even more, since no normal person ever gets that far. Any of you juggle? Who?
I said juggle problem sets sometimes.
Yes. Yes, how do you decide which problem to work on next? The one that's most attractive or the one that you want to get it over with? We were just... Anyway, that's all I wanted to say about this. There's all sorts of other stories in this. And toward the end of the chapter, here's where I start talking about Chalmers. I didn't discuss the zombie machine problem here. Maybe I'll... I have a draft of it, which I didn't put in the book, about why it's not logically possible that there could be two machines. I might be wrong. It's a nice argument, though. This week we have a visitor, Professor Takabayashi from, what's it called, university? I've known him for more than 20 years, and we've worked together from time to time on all sorts of different problems. He's expert in signal processing, made any number of inventions. I think you made the first telephone where you could speak numbers and it would dial. And at Toshiba, did they ever make a product of that?
Yeah.
Did it sell?
Yes.
Oh, good. And he made some speech recognition systems that were quite good. I know some people here who made speech recognition systems, and they wanted to make one which would still work if there were a lot of noise. So because they had some mathematical training, they said, well, of course, white Gaussian noise would be the best thing. And Yoichi Takabayashi didn't think white noise was good, so he made a lot of tapes of people saying numbers in the middle of Tokyo Station, which is the noisiest place in the world, maybe, and it's full of every kind of noise. So somehow that made his system robust enough to be a product. But anyway, for the last few years, he quit industry, became a professor, and is doing some very interesting things on common sense and this kind of high-level cognitive theory. So he's going to show you some interesting examples of that we're very interested in.
As Marvin introduced me, I used to work for the signal processing and speech recognition, and also a multimodal speech dialogue system. I'm the first person to develop the spontaneous speech dialogue system. It works. Robustly. But the problem is it's task-oriented. Then Marvin criticized me
it's a toy system. So I decided to develop a system which has the common sense. But still, the common sense means just white color common sense. Then I attended the Marvin class more than 20 years ago, to be exact, 1986. And at that time, he wrote a book on the society mind. I learned a lot from him. Then so I have been working for Toshiba for more than 20 years. Then I moved to the Shizuoka University as a professor. Then I have a lot of freedom to do the basic research. Then I started the infant learning research. So today I'll introduce about the present research on the infant the learning. Actually, it's a common sense computing. This is a whole scope of our infant learning project. So the Japanese people are good at making a product in real world, not conceptually. But I used to work for the speech recognition system for practical system as a commercial product. We observed lots of data to extract the very essential component. And I myself, I think, I believe I know what's important and what's trivial. So then we started this infant learning product project. We have the classroom, actually the co-education environment for parents and infants. Because in Japan, the infants are changing and parents are changing. Japan used to be a very safe country, very few the crimes. And when I was the kid, we didn't lock my house. It's very safe.
The first time I went to Japan, I had a 12-year-old daughter.
Uh-huh.
And she wanted to go and look at Kyoto, and everybody said it's perfectly safe. So she went all by herself. And
but now it's very dangerous. So that, and
did I ever tell you the story? She went to an arcade, which had a arcade game called Galaga, and it had a lot of boys playing it, and so she had some coins, so she got a turn, and then she broke the record. she kept shooting down more, whatever they were. And when she finished, all the boys had disappeared.
But anyway, we are designing the classroom, infant learning classroom, and the playroom. And so the purpose for our research is to develop the common sense computing model, and also designing and developing the good materials for infant education and the infant learning. So we are focusing on the constructing infant behavior corpus. So Marvin told many good the articles related to the how mind works and the common sense that works. But infant is very simple. Relatively much simpler than the adults. So we started this research, this kind of research. So again, the purpose of the project is conduct basic common sense research based on the scientific data, real world data. Infant expressions are genuine and good for modeling. It's easier. And then produce rich theories for common sense computing. The other purpose is to support healthy development of the infant, as I mentioned earlier. The parents is an important Parenting is an important issue in Japan now, and I think in this country, and also created multimodal knowledge contents for parenting. So this is a trick. Infant learning itself is very good applications. I hope Japanese government and U.S. government
get funding it now.
Now? Oh, Japanese government. But small funding. And this is the classroom. I show you these demos. Brief explanations. It's very usual. So this is made by cedar trees. Cedar trees that causes lots of allergy in your country, but it's good for the child classroom, infant classroom. Goku?
It's pasture this afternoon.
Yeah.
It's the building.
Yeah, building, yeah. cedar tree trees and four cameras and listen.
Different. Okay. I'll be back to that. What's your yo? Doesn't understand. Huh? Oh, that's it.
This is the scenery of the education. The mothers and the infants, they're working together.
Go to school at age one.
Sorry?
We don't have many children in school at age one.
Yeah, same thing happened in Japan. And it's good. Actually, in Japan, the government controlled the elementary school. But before the elementary school, it's very free.
Oh, I see.
So we can do our own, you know, strategy to do the good educations. So the practice of infant school is we are now having participants of 1 to 3 year old children and their mothers. But from the next April, we have 1 to 4 year old children. So we are continuously doing the experiment to do research and for designing the good environment.
Very good, because in 100 years, you'll have everyone.
So you can have a chance to do this kind of. So the classroom is half an hour, and the playroom and parenting and counseling is half an hour. Again, this is a trick. It's good for the parents, so we can get scientific data to do research. To the basic research. So at this moment, the long-term recording of data, we 22 months since June of 2005, and 146 occasions of classroom and playrooms, more than 200 hours of recording the movie of the speech data. And we are trying to accumulate over child care know-how from child care in the clinic to the family. It is good for the family, and so that's why we can and do the very useful experiment, like parents connecting to the our class, and other schools are related. Can be related to the our classes. Okay. And the reason why to do our project is based on the Marvin's the Emotion Machine book, especially the practice of a push scenario. I'll show you very interesting experimental data. We put the blocks in our playroom, and infants did collaboration by accident. I'll show you which is the driver task.
So it's a truck or car?
Yeah, truck. The like a bus. The audio doesn't work well.
There's too many programs running at the same time.
Ah.
What happened to the same?
The sound.
You got contrast.
Yeah. No, actually, the background program is right.
Yeah, that's Microsoft. Oh, yeah. Writing.
That's how babies cry in Japanese. Yeah. So among the lots of recorded data, we can choose the interesting parts.
Yeah.
The 3 and 4.
Oh, okay.
So,
because younger ones wouldn't negotiate that well. Have they seen the movie from Push Thesis?
I don't think so.
Push Thesis wrote this PhD thesis with a model of the first three layers of the motion machine architecture that has two robots. And one runs into trouble, and the other figures out how to help it. So, did you program a three-year-old to do?
This is a problem-solving example. So sometimes he uses a higher level the knowledge. Now we have cameras on the top.
What's the speed record?
Yeah.
Stop.
Sorry, that the audio doesn't work well. They usually more cute. Describing this behavior using a knowledge representation language like EMR, emotion machine, and the type of representation by push. And
did you ask him what his goals are?
Yeah, but we have a conference. What the, about the goals and what the reasons or some the behaviors. So every week we have discussions. What's going on there? And but it's hard to ask the infant. Switch.
I think it's worth mentioning that in. In modern psychology, people are trained to do experiments and they have large numbers of subjects and control groups, and they do the same thing with 50 children and then some slightly different thing with 50 others. And there's very little support for experiments like this. But historically, almost a very large fraction of what we know about young children comes from the psychology, psychologist Jean Piaget, who studied three children for many years. Also, my friend Bob Lawler studied three children for many years. And they learn a lot about the child's development, whereas it's very hard in modern psychology because they want statisticians to say what's significant. So you need 50 children, and then if enough of the children do the same thing, then that's what you publish. But what you really want, all children are different. You really want to know what happens in the course of one child's development. So she knows it's to be broken.
Yes. So this is the audio and the video data. And again, we're trying to describe the this behavior by natural language and also the knowledge, AI type knowledge representation language.
So did he switch to building because she said to?
Yeah.
Thank you.
So I don't give a good demo. So
so have you assembled a sequence of one of the child's development yet?
Sorry?
Have you got snaps of what one child does for 3 years?
Yeah. This year the third year, so we can collect the same child for 3 years, the child development.
Because it would be nice to know how she gets the idea of cooperating.
Yes. So yes.
Do you have examples of that?
Yeah. Oh.
That we can see.
I think he uses it for taking notes by saying this action might show level 4, that sort of thing.
Okay.
So I will give. So this kind of explanation. This is reflective thinking level and self-reflective thinking. And so we can describe the behavior using multi-level the representation that you are learning in this class.
But you don't know if the boy
thinks
that about the mother in that case, does he? Is there any evidence?
Oh, yeah, it's just an assumption, and we are just the thinking and discussing what's going on.
Yeah.
So the description is not just a single, multi-ways, but getting more and more data and making a model, I think.
Is mother in the room now?
Yes.
Oh, so you could see if he looks over at her head.
Yeah. Sometimes. Oh, this case is not, no parents. So this is such kind of representations. And we have a graphical user interface to put the functions of the EM1.
If you had a picture of mother, it would be interesting to see if his strategy is different.
Yeah, actually, I gave the videos for 1 year long, you know, infant development for the service. Mm-hmm. It's a good souvenir for grandparents and as a DVD format.
Packard has a nice story. I'm sure you all know the famous experiment of Piaget where you pour water from a full thin glass into a short fat glass. And Papert did a lot of those experiments in Geneva with Piaget. So typically the 5-year-old thinks there's more in the, or says there's more water in the tall one. So he had a boy who had a movie of a boy doing that. And then when the boy was seven years old, he did the same experiment. And the boy said, well, of course, they're equal. It's the same water. And then Papert showed the boy the movie 2 years ago where he said there's more. And the boy gets very angry and said, I never believed that. And Papert said, well, there's the movie. And the boy said, you must have had somebody make up this fake movie. I was never so stupid. It's kind of infant amnesia of a very strong form. The boy didn't believe he could ever have made that mistake. So you can use that on...
Yeah.
You can show them the video in 3 years and see if they believe it.
So it's just an ongoing project. But
we want to develop the computational model for common sense reasoning. I think it is not only for the infant. Some part of this the common sense reasoning model work for the adults, we believe. And this is just the 6 months long project. And as far as the modeling, we are collecting the data. And, we are building more the models for the common sense computing.
Deb Roy is collecting a huge amount of data, but I'm not sure it's so organized as this.
Oh, the different thing is we have increment. We our data is incremental. So the I think it's slightly different. Deb Roy has been doing good research for the very deep model of the speech and language development. But our data is a multimodal, including gestures. For instance, at the beginning, just the behavior. Then the communications is useful. Then the behaviors changes to the gestures. So some symbolic meaning appears. So now our research is language development and gestures development. Yeah, especially my colleague Kiriyama. He has a 2 months old baby. So it's good the opportunity for him to observe his baby.
Free babysitting.
Yeah. So this evening. Our computer doesn't work well. Thank you. Thank you very much for attention. Yeah.
How many common sense facts have we been able to collect so far in those first months?
Sorry?
How many facts, common sense facts, have we been able to collect?
It's hard to the count. As I mentioned, model infant behavior corpus. The corpus means the collecting the video and audio data and annotation. Annotation is a natural language and also the some sort of the knowledge representation language. So yeah. So the huge amount of data and we are the changing the representation. Our representations are evolving.
Data. Mm-hmm. It's the raw data. So.
in Piaget's laboratory, which I guess closed in around the late
1970s. In Geneva, there were many wonderful experiments. It was a small lab. I think it had about 8 or 10 people. And there were long studies watching one child learn to build things with blocks. I knew one of the researchers. I'm looking for two blocks. But Annette, I'll remember names again. She did experiments where the child had seen someone else build a T-shape, just
a thing like that. So, sorry, that the microphone. And
so after a while, all children learn that if you have the vertical block, you should put the long horizontal block around in the middle. And I'm blocked on the name of the experimenter. So she made a block that, like a loaded dice, she drilled a little hole and put a lead weight in one end, covered it up and varnished it so you couldn't tell. And so then the block would have to be off center. So what was interesting is that the 3-year-olds had a lot of trouble with that. And they would keep putting it in the center, it would fall over, and they wouldn't know what to do. And then slightly older children would realize there was something wrong with the block, and they would just push it until it balanced nicely, even though it was off center. And it was sort of unusual developmental scenario, because then a slightly older child would be as bad as the 3-year-old, because the older child knew that it had to be symmetrical, didn't know the imbalance was very, very small. So the older child persisted much longer in trying to make it centered, because he knew it had to be centered. So you had a developmental curve like that instead of the usual getting better and better. And then, of course, a yet older child would quickly say, well, it must have a weight in this end, so they'd be happy at the first try, because it wouldn't have fallen over in the middle if it didn't. So you could see, I mean, I'm just inferring all that from just seeing what happened, and you're guessing that why the really old child instantly makes the right theory and doesn't mind that it's unsymmetrical. So until we can actually look into their brain, we just have to guess what's going on there. But if Piaget hadn't done the experiments, maybe the question would never arise. In fact, I did some experiments after that, making complicated things and asking children where the center was. And it wasn't a scientific study, but it was amazing. Even very young children would instantly find the center of an object once they knew what I was looking for, even if it were complicated swirls and things. I have no idea how they do it. Well, every clue gives you, I think once you have a scanner that's not interfering with the child, then you take all your theories that came from this, and maybe in a much shorter time you can say, well, we can throw half those theories out right away because of something we saw in the brain. Nobody knows what'll happen if we can get fast, high-resolution pictures of the brain, then we might as well start over with everything, because
generally, the brain scientist doesn't have any interest in the high-level theory.
Well, they sort of have very high-level theories from clinical and very low-level theories from looking at cells. And they're trying to find theories in between. But since they, as far as I can see, what you have to do is take the AI thing and work down, because otherwise you wouldn't guess what to look for. Like in there's this old idea that I call a difference engine, which I got from Newell Simon. It says, if you have a goal, then the simplest explanation is the old cybernetic idea. There's something that has a representation of the properties that you want, and there's something else that is making a representation of what it observes, and there has to be something to see. What's the difference between those lists? And then there has to be something to say, well, which of those features should I try to reduce next? And unless you have a theory like that, you wouldn't know what to look for. And I'm sure eventually somebody will think of two or three other ideas for representing goals, but this is the only one that's ever worked in programs. So there's a series of papers right around 1960 by Alan Newell and Herbert Simon, where they made programs that solved some problems by formulating things as goals and processes that would look for differences between situations and try to remove them. It's sort of obvious, but I haven't seen that idea lately. It sort of died out for some reason. Time's up, but if anybody has a... Thanks, Yoichi. You have to come back in a year or two and see what the five-year-olds are doing. Well, when do they go to school and then you lose them?
No, six-year-old.
Uh-huh. Plenty of time then.
Weekend. Saturday and Sundays.
But in any case, I think if you knew how a five-year-old worked, you would be almost all the way home.
I hope so.
If you take all the things robots can do today, that includes almost none of what a five-year-old can do. In fact, why do we need school?